Hey everybody, welcome back to Chipstock Investor. We're going to be focusing on a memory company, SK Hynix. We've been getting a lot of questions about high bandwidth memory or HBM, and SK Hynix is the leader in these memory chips. Is it the company that you need to know about? Are memory chips now no longer a commodity? And how should you approach investing in SK Hynix, if at all? But before we continue, quick word from the sponsor of today's video, finchat.io.
As you probably know, we use finchat.io extensively in our research process, including in this video. You'll see some charts that explain and help break down the financials for this company. One nice thing about finchat.io is sometimes it can be difficult to find good, accurate financial data for a company that's not based in the United States. SK Hynix, of course, is covered over at finchat.io. Everything you need to analyze the business is right there in their platform.
And you can get 15% off any paid plan with the link in our description below. That's finchat.io/CSI. Gets you 15% off any paid plan. finchat.io/CSI. Before we talk extensively about SK Hynix, tell us what HBM is, Nick.
That's a good idea. Okay, there seems to be some confusion about this. So let's just break it down in very simple terms. HBM stands for high bandwidth memory. We're on the third generation of that, which is why you often see it stylized as HBM3, especially when companies like NVIDIA, Broadcom, and AMD are talking about their accelerated computing systems. But very simply put though, HBM is just DRAM, dynamic random access memory. And these DRAM chips are stacked on top of each other in a 3D architecture. You have those through silicon vias to attach those DRAM chips. And then they are co-packaged directly on the server system or the accelerated computing system alongside the CPU and the GPU directly on the same substrates, then the same circuit board. So you boil it all down. This is really just a very advanced, complex DRAM memory product.
The HBM market can be boiled down to basically three companies. SK Hynix is the leader, and then Micron, as well as Samsung, both huge memory chip makers. CXMT, that's a company based out of China. They're a memory chip maker, and they're just beginning their journey into HBM, which we'll discuss a little bit later. HBM memory fits into that top end market segment in our chart here, accelerated computing and AI infrastructure. But those other end markets, consumer, cloud and enterprise, auto and industrial, all have memory chips. And so these companies make components or memory chips for these end markets. And actually, that's where the bulk of their revenue still comes from.
Yeah, that's right. And that's an important point because that includes SK Hynix. So the story for SK Hynix has been, yes, it's the HBM market leader. They were the first to supply NVIDIA with HBM for their accelerated computing systems. But even so, SK Hynix is still highly reliant on some of these older memory technologies, DRAM and NAND, or SSDs, solid state drives. You can catch some of our videos that we've talked about this extensively, like Pure Storage, linked that in the description below. But the point here is HBM is growing very, very fast. But HBM was only about 40% of SK Hynix's DRAM sales in the last reported quarter, which means as a percentage of total revenue, HBM was just 30% of total sales, just over $4.1 billion. Now, the company did post a really good quarter overall. Revenue was up 12% quarter over quarter, 75% year over year. Again, this is much like what Micron just reported. Catch our video on that about a month ago. The good news here is that per bit memory growth is still expected to increase in 2025, and average selling prices are expected to increase on DRAM. We have hit a bit of a cyclical downturn for NAND memory, SSDs. We'll see how things pan out later in the year for NAND, but the expectation is that per bit growth will continue to increase. But to boil it all down here, yes, SK Hynix is one of the companies you definitely want to focus on if you're interested in HBM and the accelerated computing market and the importance of memory chips in accelerated computing and AI. However, just remember, there is a lot of other stuff going on besides just HBM. And those other markets are still highly cyclical.
Yes, exactly, Nick. Everything not AI or AI infrastructure related has been in a cyclical slump. And that's where this chart right here comes in, a U-shaped recovery. Things have stayed down longer than anyone expected, but we do expect at the second half of 2025 to start to see a recovery for all those other end markets, which is, as we mentioned, the bulk of the revenue for companies like SK Hynix. And as SK Hynix laps the effects of the last cyclical downturn for memory, their profit margins are rapidly recovering. Key in on that gross profit and operating profit margins, you can see up big year over year. So this begs the question, is SK the memory chip company that you need to know about? It very well could be. SK and Micron are making a very strong case for being leaders in this particular memory growth cycle. Let's move on to point number two. Is memory no longer a commodity cyclical market because of this HBM? We've had a lot of discussion about this over on our Discord server about this question exactly. Will the memory market be less cyclical? And I really feel like the goal of the slide deck, as well as a lot of commentary from management at SK Hynix during their call, heavily skewed towards getting us, the investor, to believe that this memory market is going to be much different than in the past. That because of the demand from AI and AI infrastructure, memory is not going to be just a commodity anymore. One quote in particular from management stood out to me. They said, as AI memory demand grows, the memory industry is transitioning from a commodity market driven by volume and price to a customized market focused on high performance and high quality products. Now, is this completely true?
To be fair, Casey, this is actually very similar commentary coming from Micron. And, you know, this is actually the commentary memory chip makers have been proffering us investors for many years. This is not the first growth cycle where we've heard, hey, this time it's going to be different. The memory chips are so complex, it's no longer a commodity. Let's just maybe go back to point one, though. And remember, yes, HBM is a big leap in manufacturing complexity over and above just your plain vanilla DRAM chip. But the bulk of revenue for SK Hynix is still coming from older memory chips, which the company acknowledges and in fact calls commodity market memory. So in other words, what we're hearing on the call is, we're no longer a cyclical commodity business, but we're currently in the midst of a commodity cycle. So it's a little bit contradictory. So I guess the argument that we're hearing from those that say, you know what, this time it is going to be different, is HBM will change that story, because maybe eventually the legacy memory sales dwindle away to a minimal amount. Maybe they get completely replaced entirely by HBM revenue. And because of that, this new HBM memory market, things will actually be different for SK Hynix, for Micron, Samsung, and so on and so forth. I wouldn't count on that. HBM is not going to completely replace these legacy markets. There is a lot of different type of memory that is needed in computing systems. HBM is just merely one type of ingredient that is needed. And I would seriously doubt SK management, and especially SK Hynix's shareholders, would want them to just completely write off all of that work that they've done in building up that, you know, so-called commodity legacy memory market over the many years that they've been doing it now. That said, HBM manufacturing equipment is what is going to gobble up most of the company's capital expenditures, or CapEx, for 2025. So I can hear the arguments ramping up already. SK Hynix is ditching the legacy products. And so, okay, let's just talk about this for a moment, about this scenario with HBM, and assume this is the future. This is the only thing SK is going to do.
Management did say that the majority of that CapEx spend would be concentrated on HBM infrastructure. On the right, SK Hynix outlined some of the places they're going to be spending that money. some new fabs in South Korea, as well as some in the United States. They're going to be focusing on that HBM infrastructure market. However, there are some risks that we need to talk about. You can think back to that slide where we had the memory maker logos. CXMT was the Chinese company that we mentioned. SK Hynix was asked about the Chinese manufacturers and the competition that they face in the earnings call. Nick, what did they have to say about that?
Yeah, just a few years ago, there was some very, very advanced memory products where the memory chip makers were saying, it's so complex, the cycle is going to be different, we're going to be able to stave off the competition. But here we are a few years later, and things like DRAM, DDR4, and DDR5 now have lots of competition from these Chinese memory fabs. The same thing is going to happen with HBM. Remember, it is very complex, but HBM is basically just 3D stacked DRAM chips. CXMT in particular is sampling, I believe it's HBM2. Eventually, they will probably figure out how to do HBM3. Yes, they are a few years behind, but the fact is, companies like SK and Micron and Samsung are always going to have to spend lots of money to stay ahead of the curve. And as long as they stay ahead of the curve, that's great. But the few years previous generation memory chips are always going to get overrun by lots of competitors that figure out how to play catch up. So this is kind of a never-ending endurance race for a manufacturer like SK Hynix. It's still ultimately a commodity product. And I think we can take a look at our hierarchy of the economy chart to help illustrate why that is, why HBM memory is still ultimately going to be a cyclical commodity product.
The first thing that is very important to remember about commodities is that commodity doesn't necessarily refer to the complexity of the product. We're focusing on the middle portion of our hierarchy of the economy chart, the infrastructure. Memory is just one ingredient for the entire recipe that fits into the AI infrastructure. We'll give you an example of how the complexity of something doesn't necessarily eliminate it from being a commodity. You can think about bread. Bread can either be sold in a loaf or it can be sold as sliced bread. Even though that it's more convenient and maybe takes a little bit more complex of a process to slice the bread, it doesn't make it less of a commodity. If you think about it like this, HBM, it's still a commodity.
Reason number two, let's go back to our hierarchy of the economy chart. Again, like Casey said, focusing on the infrastructure there in the middle. When you hear someone talk about a commodity, again, we're talking about not the complexity of the product, but its actual position in the economic hierarchy. HBM is not a final product or service. They're at the very, very top of the hierarchy. When you get to the top of this hierarchy and you start dealing in end markets, when a product has been finished, a service has been finished and sold to the end user, the business cycle tends to elongate. There's always still a cycle, even with these end markets as well, but the cycles tend to be longer. As you work your way down the hierarchy of the economy, not only does the market get smaller, but when you get into these manufacturing layers and the infrastructure layers, and even further down, the actual raw energy or data layers of the economy, the cyclicality increases. And one of the reasons for that is because you're dealing with inventories of product, manufacturing processes. And so, yes, HBM is very complex. It requires tight integration with partners like NVIDIA and Broadcom and AMD, but you're still dealing with this middle layer of the hierarchy, and you're always going to have elevated cyclicality for a business that participates in this area.
The third point that we need to remember is that management from SK also admits that they need to collaborate with companies like NVIDIA. And ultimately, you know that NVIDIA is working with all of these companies. They are coordinating with all HBM providers to get them up and running. NVIDIA is the one that actually controls the supply chain.
So in summary, I think it would be best for investors to just continue thinking of memory chip makers like SK Hynix and Micron, regardless of how much HBM they make, how complex it gets, how in deep they get in with NVIDIA and Broadcom and AMD, still think of them as a commodity. And remember, we're not talking about their products not being complex, not being really cool, but don't fool yourself into buying a business or a stock for the wrong reasons. Cyclical businesses are just fine. There's nothing wrong with investing in a cyclical business. Just go into it with the proper expectation. So I think that basically dovetails into point number three. Is SK Hynix stock a good buy if you're looking to invest at all?
That is the million-dollar question, isn't it? You can approach this much like you would a company like Micron. We did a video of this about a month ago, which we'll link here. But let's take a look at this chart from our friends at FinChat with a look at the historical profitability for SK Hynix and their EBITDA, earnings before interest, tax, depreciation, and amortization, as well as their net income. Nick, can you decode this for us?
Yeah, we've been talking with our members over on Semiconductor Insider. One way you could address and analyzing a cyclical business like SK Hynix is drawing a historical average line through the profitability. So basically, you're going to cut off all of the peaks in the profit that you see and cut out all of the bottoms as well and fill those in. What you're left over with is the CAGR there at the bottom, the compound average compound annual growth rate, about 13% for EBITDA, about 10% for net income. Let's just call it an average of 11.5%. Now, based on the commentary from all of these companies, there's questions about whether it's believable or not, but the forecasts are we have at least 2 to 3 years of high growth for accelerated computing and thus the HBM market. So if you were thinking about doing a DCF, a discounted cash flow analysis, you could maybe plug in 11.5% growth for 3 years, and then maybe use a memory market average growth rate for the terminal growth rate. Let's call that 5%. That's generally what the sales growth rate is historically for memory chips. 10% discount rate. Perhaps SK Hynix stock isn't such a bad buy right here, if you believe we have 3 years of very rapid growth left to go, and then at some point we hit another down cycle. Maybe the stock is even a double from where it's at right now. It's hard to say because we just don't know how long these cycles last, and especially when we're in the midst of a new market being created in accelerated computing. Of course, the best time to buy is during cyclical downs, but obviously that ship sailed already. So at this point, we're at least a year now into this new growth cycle for the memory market. And we believe, and the approach we take is, it's best to just be cautious. And if you buy at all, use a very small dollar cost average plan, DCA, nibble in batches, maybe like on a quarterly basis, and just take it slow and make sure your memory chip companies, your memory chip stocks are part of a diversified basket of other semiconductors. And of course, not just semiconductors, other businesses as well that participate in other industries and that are going to have different business cycles so that you don't get wiped out by what is almost certainly going to be another memory down cycle at some point in the future.
Thanks everybody for watching this episode. Make sure you sub to the channel, hit the like button, make sure you have notifications enabled so you actually can watch our videos. Check out Semiconductor Insider membership. That membership gives you access to our Discord server, all of our show notes, live Q&As weekly. You can join that membership via our Ko-fi page. Link is in the description below. We'll see you all again very soon at Chipstock Investor.